Matthew Arnold's Dover Beach follows a pattern that was familiar in romantic poetry, an observation of something in nature followed by a meditation.
The speaker of this poem is on the cliffs of Dover. Tall white chalk cliffs bunch like these, although we are actually west of Dover on the southern coast of England. The speaker looks out at the sea. Note the natural description. The sea is calm tonight. The tide is full. The moon lies fair upon the straits. On the French coast, the light gleams and is gone. The cliffs of England stand glimmering and vast out in the tranquil bay. The reference to the French coast notes the fact that on clear days, it's possible to see the coast of France from the cliffs of Dover. In line 6, we learn that this poem is a dramatic monologue. We have a fictional, unnamed speaker who in line 6 speaks to his companion, apparently the woman he loves. He calls her to come to the window and to enjoy the sweet night air.
Then in line 9, he tells her to listen. The sounds that he describes are not as beautiful as the visual scene that he has described. On the southeast coast of England, the beaches are rocky.
The grating roar of the pebbles as the tide recedes brings a note of sadness to the speaker. He imagines the Greek playwright Sophocles hearing the same sound on the Aegean Sea and thinking of human misery, which he portrays in his plays. Now, here in England, this speaker hears the same sound and he too thinks of human misery. In the third stanza, Arnold introduces his famous metaphor, the sea of faith. The sea of faith was once too at the full. The sea of faith refers to people's religious faith. Once, the speaker says, religious faith was full and strong like the tide when it's full. Now, however, in the Victorian era, the speaker says he can hear only the melancholy, long withdrawing roar as religious faith seems to be receding from the earth like the receding tide. This poem is one of the classic statements of the Victorian conflict between faith and doubt. Consider some of the factors that affected the sense of some Victorians that religious faith was fading in the world.
In the final stanza, Arnold finds the only consolation that he can in this world. Ah, love, let us be true to one another. For the world which seems to lie before us like a land of dreams, so various, so beautiful, so new, hath really neither joy, nor love, nor light, nor certitude, nor peace, nor help for pain. And we are here as on a darkling plain, swept with confused alarms of struggle and flight, where ignorant armies clash by night.